Right, good afternoon from Malaysia, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back from the break. We promised you that we shall start our afternoon session, GMT plus 8 time at 2 p.m. sharp, and we're back. So it's good to have all of you back. We certainly hope that you're all refreshed. We're about to move very quickly on to our next session. This is the panel discussion on evolution of Islamic finance in the halal economy and contribution to global economic recovery. Now, the halal industry needs to work hand in hand with the Islamic finance industry. The end result of marrying the two industries together will actually help us create a truly halal economy, a concept that was first proposed at this very conference way back in 2011. The halal industry could see massive gains through participation in the flourishing sukuk market. Indeed, the MIFC reported that the global sukuk market grew 16.5% to $572.6 billion US dollars in the year 2020, with Malaysia taking the largest slice at 45.1%, or just around 258 billion US dollars. Malaysia has also issued more sukuk tied to the principles of sustainable and responsible investment, SRI, funding ventures involving renewable energy infrastructure and social purposes such as education and microfinance. As more businesses and individuals are becoming increasingly cash-strapped due to lockdown restrictions, it is actually imperative to provide more Islamic financing options such as sukuk and takaful. While there has been some progress in this respect, we must do more to keep up with the high demand. We're about to move on to the opening remarks from the Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Malaysia, Dato' Abdul Rashid Ghaffour, who is responsible as the Deputy Governor for the financial sector's regulation and development, including payment systems, as well as the international reserve management and money market operations and foreign exchange administration. Dato' Abdul Rashid is currently the Assistant Governor and he is responsible for monetary policies and economic sector, which consists of the monetary policy, economics, international and statistical services departments of the bank. Dato' Abdul Rashid is also a member of the bank's management committee, as well as several policy committees, namely the Monetary Policy Committee, Reserve Management Committee, and Risk Management Committee. Ladies and gentlemen, here's the opening remarks for our next session. Dato' Abdul Rashid Ghaffour, Deputy Governor, the Central Bank of Malaysia, otherwise known as Bank Negara.
Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And a very good afternoon to our distinguished guests and fellow audience. Thank you to the Halal Development Corporation for inviting me to deliver the opening remarks today. I wish to congratulate HDC for organizing this conference, which I believe will be inspiring and enlightening. The timing of this event could not be better, echoing the pace of an ongoing global economic recovery. The theme of this conference, Halal, the Catalyst for Universal Economic Recovery, spells out the potential for this multi-trillion dollar industry to facilitate the regeneration of the global economy. Within the global sphere, the prospect of the halal economy is huge. Global consumption of halal goods and services is expected to grow at 3.5% annually to reach $2.4 trillion by 2024, largely driven by the fast-growing Muslim population. Another contributing factor is the rising trend on ethical consumerism that primarily considers the impact of consumption. This aligns with the practice of halal toiban that propagates good, pure, and wholesome elements in consumption. At a broader level, this is also relevant in addressing growing concerns on sustainability and climate change in halal production. These global trends on halal present an excellent narrative with enormous prospects for Malaysia, given our forefront position in the global halal economy. Ranked top in both Islamic finance and Islamic economy, these trends open up opportunities to marry both of these segments. Our domestic halal market is currently valued at approximately 300 billion ringgit, contributing 7% of the country's GDP. This figure is projected to grow further to 400 billion ringgit to account for 11% of GDP by 2030. We have observed increasing prominence of Islamic financial institutions in supporting the halal sector in recent years. Although only 21.9% of Malaysian halal certified companies used Islamic finance in 2018, the number of applications from this segment has doubled to 10,800 in 2020, amounting to 63 billion ringgit. Allow me to share some thoughts on three critical factors that contribute to this positive trend, which I believe will continue moving forward. First is the value proposition of Islamic finance that extends the ability of Islamic financial institutions to offer beyond bank-based credit intermediation. The universal scope of business under the Islamic Financial Services Act 2013 allows Islamic financial institutions to mobilize different sources of funds towards delivering meaningful solutions. One example is the provision of value-added services to SMEs, such as marketplace and advisory services in trade facilitation alongside supply chain finance capability. To date, 5 Islamic banks are already offering such services through the HDC's Halal Integrated Platform. I understand that more are expected to join this digital platform later this year. Another example is the investment account, an instrument which allows Islamic banks to source risk-absorbent capital to fund high-growth halal business sectors such as pharmaceutical and cosmetics. The ability of Islamic banks to structure investment account in accordance with the risk profile and characteristics of the underlying assets offers an attractive opportunity for customers to diversify their investment portfolio across various halal subsectors. Second is the wide network of Malaysian financial institutions in facilitating halal exports to tap into regional markets. Increasing interest from ASEAN countries, which makes up 42% of the global Muslim population, as well as demand from non-Muslim dominated ASEAN countries such as Japan, Korea, and Vietnam, provide a huge halal consumption base for domestic halal businesses to tap on. Currently, 3 Malaysian financial institutions have leveraged their extensive global network and strategic partnerships to assist halal exporters gaining access to new markets. Moving forward, Malaysian financial institutions should take advantage of the strong government-to-government ties and multilateral strategic cooperation in the halal sector between countries to offer Islamic trade finance to halal industry players. The third factor is the ability of Islamic financial institutions to facilitate businesses to transition towards a more sustainable practices. The underlying concept of Makasid Sharia, which propagates for the attainment of benefits as well as preventing harm, resonates well with sustainability principles that call for a balanced, sustainable, and inclusive economic growth. Adopting sustainability practices is imperative to ensure the longevity of businesses. Failure to take this into account may result in substantial financial loss to the halal industry, given that our trade partners have started imposing expectation on sustainability as precondition to transact. For example, Malaysia's top halal export markets, for example, China, Singapore, and Japan, they are signatories to net zero target, and non-sustainability practices will lead to increased cost of business exporting into these markets. Malaysia's halal food and beverages segment, which makes up 80% of Malaysia's halal production and 86% of total halal exports, may be adversely affected by climate change. An increase in temperature will lower the resilience of the agroecosystem against pests and pathogens, resulting in lower yields and quality of crops, affecting the supply of raw materials. In addition, more MNCs are embracing the sustainability agenda, compelling halal SMEs to factor sustainability as part of their business strategies, operations, and decision-making. It is heartening that prominent halal MNC manufacturers have already started imposing sustainable practices across their supply chain. Nestle, for example, has established the Paddy Club back in 2012 as an initiative to ensure rice used for the company's cereal products is sourced sustainably and responsibly. Another example is sustainability agriculture code as a prerequisite for suppliers to enter Unilever's supply chain as part of the group's ambition to sustainable sourcing. Towards this end, IFIs have put together a lot of efforts and resources in place, underpinned by the concept of value-based intermediation, such as financing and banking activities that are in line with sustainability practices. The VBI community of practitioners, COP, have collectively issued sectoral guidelines on palm oil, renewable energy, and energy efficiency that serves as an import and an impact-based risk assessment toolkit to assist financial and investment decision of banks. The takaful industry has followed suit with the issuance of the VBI for takaful framework that integrates the principles of VBI into products and business practices that promote financial resilience and climate risk management. Before I end my remarks, I would like to touch on the importance of the right skill set that can future-proof our halal industry. As we navigate beyond the pandemic, leaders in halal business community have to be agile and forward-looking. This includes keeping abreast of latest technology and constant upskilling to embrace digitalization. In recognizing the potential of digitalization as a key ingredient to assist halal businesses, the bank provides an enabling environment for financial institutions to foster innovation, such as through the FinTech Regulatory Sandbox and facilitation of pilot projects. These avenues enable the bank to identify potential adjustments or responses to the existing regulatory framework that commensurate with the risk and scale of activities. The bank has also established the SME Automation and Digitalization Facility in March 2020, which aims to encourage SMEs to automate processes and digitalize operations to increase productivity and efficiency. In March 2021, an additional allocation of 700 million ringgit has been provided for the ADF, bringing the facility's total size to 1 billion ringgit. To conclude, Islamic financial institutions have developed into mature institutions that are now offering a wide range of financial solutions to meet the varied needs of customers. Therefore, halal businesses should seize these opportunities to better position themselves and embrace sustainability, as well as digitalization that aim to provide stronger platforms to rebound as the economy recovers. In closing, I would like to share with you an inspiring verse from the Quran that serves as a foundation to the key points I have intended to raise earlier. In Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 195, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala mentioned, "And do good. Indeed, Allah loves the doers of good." So let us embrace this message together and put more efforts in propagating a good, particularly in the way we conduct businesses, by not just being halal, but also beneficial to the environment and society at large, in line with the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And let us begin this today, here at the World Halal Business Conference 2021. Thank you, and I wish everyone a pleasant and productive conference. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh.
Thanks goes out to Dato' Abdul Rashid Ghafoor, Deputy Governor, the Central Bank of Malaysia, for the opening remarks for this next session. Ladies and gentlemen, for our next session, which will be moderated by Mr. Nur Aizat Sheikh Ahmad, General Manager, Securities Commission Malaysia, it will of course touch on the evolution of Islamic finance in the halal economy and contribution to global economic recovery. So, Mr. Nur Aizat, over to you.
Rahman, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, and very good afternoon to everyone. Firstly, I would like to thank the organizer, the Ministry of International Trade and Industry, and Halal Development Corporation for the opportunity to moderate this panel discussion with our esteemed panelists. According to the Halal Industry Master Plan 2030, the global halal market is expected to grow to $5 trillion by 2030, while the domestic growth is estimated to grow to about $113 billion by the same year. Over the years, there have been growing awareness on Islamic financing options by the players within the halal industry. As the global economy gradually recovers from the effect of COVID-19, it is imperative to provide more Islamic financing options to the halal industry, especially micro, small, and medium enterprises. The combination of these two industries together will help create a truly halal economy, a concept that was first proposed at this conference in 2011. With this as the backdrop to the discussion, let us now look forward to what would be insightful views from our esteemed panelists today. We have for the next 45 minutes or so, experts with experience and insight into this subject. And before we start, I would like to introduce them briefly. Our first panelist is Yang Berbahagia, Dato' Dr. Muhammad Daud Bakar. Yang Berbahagia Dato' is the founder and executive chairman of Amani Group. He also served as the chairman of the Syariah Advisory Council at the Central Bank of Malaysia, Securities Commission Malaysia, Labuan Financial Services Authority, Astana International Financial Center, First Abu Dhabi Bank, and Permodalan National Berhad. Yang Berbahagia Dato' also sits in multiple syariah boards of various financial institutions globally. Yang Berbahagia Dato' is also the chairman of the Federal Territory Islamic Religious Department or Majlis Agama Islam Wilayah Persekutuan. Our second panelist is Yang Berbahagia Dato' Muhammad Rafiq Marikan. Yang Berbahagia Dato' is currently the Group Chief Executive Officer, Islamic Banking Maybank, and Chief Executive Officer of Maybank Islamic Berhad. Yang Berbahagia Dato' Rafiq plays a leading role in managing and overseeing the overall Islamic banking franchise of the Maybank Group. Yang Berbahagia Dato' has close to 30 years of experience in the corporate sector. The third panelist is Encik Muhammad Suhaimi Abdul Hamid, who is currently the Chief Executive Officer at Standard Chartered SADC. His main responsibility includes to provide leadership and ensure successful execution of the bank's strategy to grow its Islamic business and franchise in Malaysia. Encik Suhaimi has over 20 years' experience in Islamic banking across retail, commercial, and corporate banking, and has garnered domestic and regional exposure throughout his career in local and multinational financial institutions. Last but not least, Encik Muhammad Izzat Fadli, who is currently the Executive Director at Wahid Technologies Serian Berhad. Encik Muhammad Izzat started his career at Permodalan National Berhad, and during his tenure at PNB, he was seconded to Singapore and had briefly worked at PNB's Tokyo and London offices between 2012 and 2015. The topic for today is evolution of Islamic finance in the halal economy and contribution to the global economic recovery, which is worthy of a research paper itself as it covers three main subjects: Islamic finance, halal economy, and economic recovery. With that, I wish to start the ball rolling by inviting each of the panelists to share their view on the topic in terms of how Islamic finance can facilitate or has facilitated the growth of halal industry and how it can contribute to the economic recovery. With that, I would like to invite our first panelist, Berbahagia Dato' Dr. Daud, to give his view, insight, and perspective on the topic. With pleasure, Dr. Daud.
Thank you. Okay. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulihi al-Ameen. Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Thank you very much, Mr. Moderator, Mr. Izzat, respected and esteemed panelists, Bahagia Dato' Rafiq, as well as Muhammad Suhaimi and Encik Muhammad Izzat. A distinguished audience, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh, and very good afternoon to everyone. Thank you for having me on this platform speaking on the center stage on leveraging on halal industry vis-a-vis Islamic finance. I would start officially, Mr. Moderator, by saying that halal industry has not been developed that much in the past because due to many other challenges, and most of them due to the physical challenges, because unlike Islamic banking and finance, the latter was very much financial, so it can be a bit speedy, a bit flexible in terms of offering. It can cut across the globe quite easily. But for halal industry, it requires a lot of, you know, immigration, a lot of value chain and transportation. I was referring to the goods in particular. But nowadays, alhamdulillah, with the advent of the technology, and yang berbahagia, the governor has mentioned about the value proposition of Islamic finance and halal industry. I would like to pick up on that by saying that halal industry has become more easy and more open and inclusive, particularly from the digital economy perspective. So now the halal industry can penetrate market which are otherwise deprived and blocked for many, many years in the past. So now we have seen how product can be sold to Indonesia, India, Pakistan without having any difficulties as we move forward. In other words, we are opening new market for Muslim segment themselves, not to mention the non-Muslim communities beyond the Muslim community. So we are creating a new demand market as we speak. So this is point number one. Point number two, even within the area of Islamic halal or halal industry, we have seen development of new products and services. Interestingly, we have seen from many presentation and data that we have, halal has moved, has perhaps diversified into services in on top of products. So we have seen the application and the animation and every single thing that requires services, there's a halal element or GPS on that. And we can have the GPS halal indicator even for services, what more for goods which are very much tangible and very much physical in nature. So this is a good thing. We are seeing a new development of new asset classes when it comes to halal businesses. The third and the last point, commenting on halal before I can link to the Islamic finance, which is our forte basically, all the speakers. I think we have a lot of experience in finance, but not necessarily in halal industry. So the inclusion, halal inclusion in the financial sector, we talk about financial inclusion in the past, and we have been able to do that. What more with the coming of technology? Even for halal has been very much open nowadays, and I have seen many technology coming up to the Muslim world, originating from the East and the West, non-Muslim jurisdiction, looking into making their product from day one. Even they say from chicken, industry, poultry industry, they have to make sure that even the technology to create the egg and to create the breeding technology and the feeding technology is Sharia compliant, which is not heard of or unthinkable in the past for many years. So this is a new thing coming up from the supply market perspective. We have the demand market and we have the supply perspective, and these are coming very aggressively in the last 6 months to 1 year basically. So we have the whole segment nowadays from demand, supply, as well as the new areas of product development and services industry. So where are we in terms of Islamic finance basically? I think for Islamic finance, we need to understand the behavior and the culture of halal industry for us to mimic and to be close to the very behavior of halal industry. So one of the issue that I wanted to mention, that I will stop at that point, is value chain financing, because in halal industry, they talk always about value chain financing from the egg, from the breeding, feeding, slaughtering, and transportation, frozen, and what have you, all the way to the packaging and whatnot. So it's like banking and finance must take along. This is the new way of doing finance if we wanted to be the natural fit and the natural pair of ESG finance moving forward. I think I will stop at that point to give more time to other speakers, and I hope the comment that I have made will open up a new a new venture, taking the challenges posed by our Honorable Deputy Governor just now, that we need to push more and push the envelope further and to make ESG finance and banking, both capital market and banking, our natural pair and natural partner to halal industry. Thank you very much, Aidan.
Thank you. Thank you, Yang Babagi Dato. I guess the point from Dato's presentation of Dato's view just now is on how Islamic financial institutions can actually have a value-based, value chain financing. On that note, I would like to invite our second panelist, Yang Berbahagia, Dato' Muhammad Rafiq, to give his views, perspective and insight, as well as perhaps to respond to what Dato' Dr. Dawood has actually mentioned about value chain financing. Is that something that the bank has already been doing, or is that something that, the bank will explore to do it? My pleasure, Dato', please.
Thank you. Thank you, Encik Nur Aizat. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Distinguished participants, fellow panelists, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, thank you for inviting me to this session, as well as congratulations to the organizers, MITI and HGB, for organizing such a global session on halal and Islamic finance. So maybe in terms of some of the points that were shared by Dato' DG, as well as Dato' Dobaka, in terms of Islamic finance and the halal economy, what we have actually seen was that in the past, the growth of the halal economy, as well as Islamic finance, was quite divergent. I think in terms of the interaction between the two through Islamic financing facilities, for example, was fairly low. But the potential for both undoubtedly has been quite significant. And the reasons for that is quite obvious. I think in terms of the growth of the Muslim population, in terms of faith-based the values, for example, coming across MNCs, recognizing the fact that the halal economy is a growth sector, as well as what we're seeing across many countries, is that halal has become a national agenda. So countries are actually adopting policies whereby the prominence of the halal economy takes on a greater significance. So what we see from the lens of Islamic financial institutions is that Islamic finance has actually grown by about almost 2.4 trillion in 2018. And what it is forecast to actually grow to over the next 5 years is about 3.5. That's about 3.5% growth, CAGR. And then for the halal economy, it is expected to grow to about 3.2 trillion by 2024, which is about 6.2% cumulative annual growth rate. Now, these are very encouraging numbers for those who actually track the growth of the halal economy. And it presents Islamic financial institutions growing with the customer base that we have with a significant opportunity in order to actually position ourselves to grow along with our customers and hence the halal economy. And what we have actually done is that we will look at it from various high-level strategic viewpoints. The first one is that we need to be able to provide solutions beyond just providing financing. Because even though financing is growing, but until we are able to actually connect with our customers and the broader base that is doing the halal economy, then there will be a missed opportunity. The other one is in terms of Islamic banks itself committing resources as well as investments to push further the agenda of integration between the halal economy and Islamic finance. The other one is working on collaborative models between non-traditional partners for Islamic financial institutions in order to push forward the agenda for the halal economy. And finally, Islamic financial institutions are tracking the impact and the outcome of its actions in terms of consolidating and amalgamating what it can actually do within the halal economy. Maybe I can elaborate a little bit more and probably even touch on also on what Yang Bahagia Datuk Daud has actually mentioned just now. So what we're seeing is that when we looked at the different segments, the players within the halal economy, each will require different types of assistance. Like for example, for the bigger corporates, they're well established and well on their way. But when it comes to the smaller players, SMEs, for example, we need to be able to firstly provide them with the awareness that Islamic financial institutions are there for them. So what we have actually done is we have actually engaged webinar sessions. We have actually provided sessions whereby they understand further the process to get halal certification. And from there, we intend to actually also provide an avenue for them to showcase their products post halal certification to other marketplaces. So this is what Datuk Gigi mentioned just now. Some Islamic banks have actually started to provide the linkage, to provide the link through different channels to marketplaces. So in the case of Maybank, for example, during this pandemic, we actually established an e-commerce platform. We call it Sama Sama Local, to help our vendors who struggle to actually connect with the market that used to actually come to their premises. So what we have actually done is we have actually linked merchants, now coming to about 5,000, to our 6 million or 7 million active MTU customers. So hopefully with that initiative, then we're able to actually provide a differentiated channel. The other one is we wanted to also create national, if not global champions. And what we have actually done is we have created a marketplace whereby we collaborate with e-commerce players so that SMEs, for example, are able to showcase their products either in Singapore or through certain platforms, even to the UK. It's still early days, but I think this is the part whereby we need to come up with solutions beyond just providing financing. We need to be able to provide an opportunity for our customers, SMEs, for example, within the halal economy, to grow further. The other one is beyond just F&B, there are other industries as well whereby it merits attention by Islamic financial institutions. And this includes travel, this includes fashion industry, this includes pharmaceutical and chemicals, cosmetics, for example. And we need Islamic financial institutions, we need to actually invest in certain understanding and capabilities in order to actually pursue the agenda further. So in the case of Maybank Islamic, for example, what we have actually done is last year, we actually established a dedicated unit to take a look at the halal industry to be more immersive within the halal context with the players so that we can understand their pain points and come up with better solutions for the whole industry. To touch briefly on the point that was raised by Dr. Daud, we continue to innovate and develop new products. For example, working with Bank Negara and the government, we have actually developed the supply chain financing through Scheme Chakna, for example, and then we have developed through our cards program, distribution cards, whereby the principal can actually work with their suppliers and their vendors in order to actually facilitate working cash flow requirements. So I'll stop there first, Shahizat, and allow for the panelists to also say their views. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Yang Bahagia Datuk. Just, I would like to remind the audience, if you have any question, please post them on Slido and we will address them accordingly. It will be great if you can also indicate it to whom the question is directed to. Please provide your name, email address, as well as your organization, if possible. May I now move to the third panelist? May I invite Encik Mohamad Suhaimi to give his perspective as the CEO of Standard Chartered SADC from an international bank perspective on this topic.
Sure.
Please, Encik Mohamad Suhaimi.
Thank you. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alamin. Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafil anbiya mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi and very good afternoon to our moderator for the session, Encik Aizat, General Manager, Security Commission of Malaysia, and esteemed panelists, our beloved and respected Datuk Dr. Muhammad Abu Bakar, Chairman of China Advisory Council of Security Commission, my dearest brothers, Datuk Umar Rafiq Barikan, CEO of Maybank Islamic, Saudara Encik Izzat Fadli, and ladies, gentlemen, thank you for taking time out to join us today. First of all, I would like to thank to organizer Halal Development Corporation for inviting me to speak today. The topic for our conference, Evolution of Islamic Finance in the Halal Economy and Contribution to Global Economic Recovery, is most appropriate. There are five key pillars that I would like to share which are relevant to this topic. One is market opportunities that have been shared largely by our Datuk DG, Datuk Bakar, and also by Datuk Rafiq just now. Number two is about robust product structure and product innovation. And number three, advanced technology and digital capability. Number four, global network advantage. And finally, we will focus on sustainability and value-based intermediation. As we are aware that worldwide, the global demand for halal product will continue to increase. The world's 1.8 billion Muslim consumers spend an estimated $2.2 trillion across different sectors of the halal economy. 5.2% year-on-year growth. The halal global economy is now estimated to be over $2.3 trillion and still growing at annual rate of 20%, driving towards its target where it was set to grow to $3.1 trillion by 2033. This is recognized as one of the main driving force of the halal industry. Today, as mentioned by Dato' Rafiq just now, the halal industry not just linked to food and beverages, but cover various segments such as cosmetic, pharmaceutical, travel, tourism, logistics, financing, and more. What happened, we can see last 2 years, the pandemic has brought on a renewed demand and perspective to halal products, as it is a hallmark of product reliability, safety, and hygiene. Yet, even before the halal sector gained in the popularity due to increased hygiene concern, Halal Toiban, in recent months, report on global and domestic halal economy showed the industry has been growing for years. The growth of the industry can actually be accelerated with great assistance of Islamic finance that been also shared by Dato' Rafiq and also Dato' Bakar just now. At Standard Chartered Bank, as the bank that has grown with this country, Malaysia, over the last 146 years, we have deep obligation to help facilitate some of that growth. It's much in line with our purpose of driving commerce and prosperity through our unit diversity. We have introduced a Halal 360 program where we offer a comprehensive set of Sharia compliant solutions that serve to address the financial need of various types of clientele, from SME to large corporate. In addition, our position as an international Islamic bank and present across Asia, Middle East, and Africa will help drive business matching opportunities for local businesses in their global expansion. Ladies and gentlemen, Islamic Finance has aggressively stepped up the game, just offering a basic current account to introducing other financial market instruments such as trade working capital and corporate finance to meet the growing needs of our client. Due to unprecedented shocks brought by pandemic for 2 years, continuous years, many companies are now rethinking and looking into their supply chain to improve their performance, sustainability by integrating environmentally and financially viable practice into complete supply chain lifestyle that can help companies conserve resources, optimize processes, uncover product innovation, save costs, increase productivity, and even promote corporate values. To remain competitive and relevant, the Islamic finance industry needs to continue to innovate to provide adequate support to businesses. I'm pleased to share that Standard Chartered SADC provides supply chain financing and vendor payment program to ease the cash flow of SMEs. On this note, we are extremely honored to be recognized as the best Islamic supply chain bank in the asset by the Asset Triple A Islamic Finance Award in 2021. This truly demonstrates our success in providing best-in-class supply chain financing to our client at a challenging time like this. The pandemic has led many banks ramping up the digital capabilities, as mentioned by our DG Rashid just now, in offering a wide range of digital solutions to support the digital transformation of businesses, but set as part is our vision in being a digital bank with a strong human touch and to be the go-to bank for SMEs and corporates. This means giving client the choice to everything digitally and still get assistance via phone, chat, or video link. Our role is to be a connector bank in using technology to connect our corporate clients, markets, and products to facilitate trade and investment. For example, we offer an award-winning state-to-bank, our corporate client, securely, they can do securely and effectively run their cash management, trade finance, foreign exchange, and security services. Its current support over 300,000 users globally and processes more than 5 million payments a month across cash, trade, and security services. On top of that, we are the first bank to offer the ability to trace all cross-border payment cleared through the bank's major clearing centers to its client, as well as to their corporate and retail client through a publicly accessible portal. We improve our client ability to track payment status and therefore facilitate movement of goods and services and growth of supply chains. Ladies and gentlemen, so much has been said about the COVID-19 pandemic and its effect on businesses. It has forced economies to go into lockdown and bring in trade activity to help. Amidst the uncertainty, the advantage of sustainable financing shown even brighter. A majority of studies looking at the relation between companies with ESG practices and their financial performance found a direct link. Companies that do good by the environment, their labor force and community do well financially. This was backed by evidence that shows companies that with good environmental and social performance tend to outperform those with poor environmental and social performance by 210 basis points on return on equity and by 110 basis points on return on asset. In Malaysia, Islamic institutions are leading the sustainability agenda and spearheading sustainable finance through the adoption of value-based intermediation initiative. The aim is to realign Islamic finance business model toward the objective of Sharia that generate positive and sustainable impact to the economy, community, and environment. As an chartered bank, we play a vital role in helping our market realize the SDGs. We are playing our part to tackle climate change, having committed to facilitating and financing $35 billion US dollar worth of clean tech and renewable between 2020 and to 2025. With a focus on emerging markets. With that, I look forward to an interesting and insightful discussion as our panel discussion after this, and hope all of you walk away with a fresh perspective on the evolution of Islamic finance in the halal economy. Thank you.
Thank you, Encik Muhammad Saimi, for the very insightful views on what Standard Chartered has actually accomplished so far. May I remind the audience again to please submit your question if you have any through the Slido. We will be taking the question and we will post the question to the panelists. May I now invite our fourth panelist, Encik Muhammad Izzat, to give his view and perspective. Encik Muhammad Izzat, of course, is the ED of Wahid Invest, the first digital investment manager. Islamic licensed by the SC in 2019. May I invite you, Encik Muhammad Izzat?
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum and good afternoon to my esteemed panelists, participants of the conference, and also to all the audience. The topic that is proposed here is quite extensive in terms of the range. So what we'll try to do here is to tackle it by shedding light on the more recent developments in the Islamic finance landscape, particularly from the fintech perspective or the financial technology. So currently, there are more than 250 Islamic fintech players globally in various segments of the industry, such as crowdfunding, P2P financing, payment, e-wallet, as well as robo-advisors such as ourselves. Digital finance has taken center stage over the last decade, and this is further pushed by the recent economic difficulties faced by many from the pandemic. With it, Islamic finance has also gained more traction as it becomes more accessible and more affordable through fintech solutions. We have seen financial providers such as governments and FIs adopting fintech in assisting the public with zakat, wakaf, and even direct benefits to minimize the recent hardships and also to support the local businesses. And as alluded by Dato' Dr. Muhammad Daud earlier, the fintech companies is also needed in terms of financial inclusion perspective as well. These companies are able to reach out to micro enterprises, to the fringe players, and what this can do is also tap into the more informal sectors of the economy. And with improving digital readiness globally, aided by better infrastructure, higher smartphone penetration rates, and strong support from government regulators, as well as the Islamic finance communities, we are seeing more people getting easier access to financial solutions. And what this does is there is a quicker response to economic needs when they arise, as access to capital becomes more efficient. And those that require funds can easily be matched with investors. And in the Islamic finance, they can be matched in a Sharia compliant manner as well. And further benefits of the utilization of fintech includes better transparency, because you can exercise due diligence better, because both beneficiary and the funder can exchange extensive information. And what this does is this mitigates the trust deficit even between two parties that uses fintech as the medium. And speaking from our own experience at Wahid Invest, we started our robo-advisory business in the US around 5 years ago with the aim to provide Muslim Americans the ability to grow their wealth in a halal and diversified manner. And we are encouraged to see our impact there, where those wanting to align their investment needs with their faith put their trust with us to manage their funds. And this has enabled us to create our own exchange traded fund, the Halal ETF, Bloomberg ticker HALALUS, which is the first Sharia compliant ETF listed on the NASDAQ. And with it, investors from all over the world are now able to have exposure in Sharia compliant US companies in order to grow their wealth in a diversified manner. And since then, we have expanded to the UK and Malaysia, where, as the moderator Chaizat mentioned earlier, we are licensed as the first Islamic digital investment management company here. And the trends that we are seeing here are also encouraging and interesting, where the client base is on average below 30 years old. So it's still young demographics trying to grow their wealth. And in terms of where they are from, they are also split with half of them coming from outside of Klang Valley. So this strengthens our belief that fintech solutions are crucial in the effort to improve financial inclusion, as we see the reach, not just from the younger demographics, but also from those in rural areas as well. In addition to that, through digital services, not just financial inclusion, literacy can also be improved as users are able to explore more options. The offerings can encompass those with low financial knowledge to those with high financial knowledge. And in time, through these various options, the hope is that the knowledge gap may be narrowed. And to give an example, Takatech products or Takaful FinTech products can cover the smallest of insurance. For example, be it a daily travel insurance to the more general life insurance, which is a higher value insurance. Therefore, with this wide range of coverage, it becomes more attractive to users and it allows them to be more informed with Takaful space as a whole. While all that was mentioned before is good, there are still challenges that we have to address. And the first challenge is something that Dato' Rafiq mentioned earlier, which is it can still take time for incumbents to reroute their strategy to embrace the digitalization of their offerings. And as Dr. Rafi has mentioned, one way that this can be addressed is by partnerships with fintech providers. And the second challenge that we see is digital literacy, which can sometimes be poor among certain demographics. And of course, this can be tackled by incentive programs, as we saw last year from the government, to increase digital adoption and subsequently increase digital literacy as well. And the third challenge that we see in this fintech space is the Islamic fintech human capital. And this is something that MDEC brought up last year as well, which can be further developed. While, for example, Malaysia is not short of Islamic finance talents, it is always good to marry that with tech knowledge as well. And those with both Islamic fintech are not readily available as of yet. So I think, I guess to summarize my points, is that we see fintech as a key driver within the Islamic finance space to contribute not just to the economic recovery brought by the pandemic, but also to growth going forward. So with that, I yield my time and I go back to moderator. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Encik Muhammad Izzat. Yes, definitely, fintech and digital is the way forward. Not only in Islamic finance, but also within the halal industry as well. Perhaps I can pose a question to Dato' Muhammad Rafiq, just a follow-up question to what you have actually mentioned earlier. I think you mentioned that Maybank has created awareness among the small and medium enterprises in terms of the various options within the Islamic finance product and services. But there are still perceptions, whether rightly or wrongly, that Islamic financing is expensive. How do we actually debunk that perception? I think especially amongst the smaller SMEs who may not be familiar with Islamic financing.
Thank you. Thank you, Jezat, for the question. So I think what we have actually done was, when it comes to, especially for the segments whereby the terms and pricing are important, then Islamic financial institutions need to be competitive. And the test, I suppose, in terms of acceptance is, last year, for example, in Malaysia, conventional grew by 0.5%, and the Islamic finance industry grew by about 8.5%. So we do see, for example, when it comes to those who actually take on Islamic financing, the growth has been very, very encouraging. And I would suggest that those who actually do have both conventional and Islamic, take a look at some of the terms within the financing facilities that they have and make a comparison. I think probably one of the features that is currently also quite topical within the Islamic finance facility is the fact that when it comes to terms which are fairer, when it comes to terms which comply with Sharia from values perspective, for example, it resonates well with the customer. So our experience for Maybank Islamic, we do find that it is not necessarily faith-driven if the values are consistent. So we do have customers who are coming from the Muslim faith, and we also have quite a big sizable proportion coming from the non-Muslim segment who equally embrace Islamic finance. And we need to be competitive in order to actually appeal to both sets of customer base.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Dato. I think we have one question. Perhaps I can pose this question to Encik Muhammad Suhaimi. What role should Islamic Bank play to promote and support the halal economy globally and locally and globally?
Sure. Bismillah Rahim, what actually the bank rules, especially for us like international bank, actually what we can do, we have the local entrepreneurs to penetrate their product to global market. For example, if they have intention to grow big and would like to penetrate either country like Bangladesh, Pakistan or UAE, we can help them by the business matching. And as you know, when it comes to the local entrepreneur, the key risk to expand the business is country risk. They don't know how to really penetrate the bank, the funds, and whether they do have the right partner, right buyer and supplier if they send the product globally. So that's why, you know, similarly like Dato' Rafi just now shared that how they're able to help these local players to penetrate the market using our data intelligence, because we are present in Bangladesh, Pakistan, UAE, Saudi, even in Africa. So using that, our global network print, we're able to, you know, help all these entrepreneurs to go global, that one. And number two, for global players, those who actually, you know, for example, they are based in Dubai and never been in Malaysia. So we help two ways. We bring the foreign direct investment from this potential client, bring FDI to Malaysia. We work closely with Maida. and for export product from outside from Malaysia to other part of the world, we work closely with Matrade. That actually our role as the global bank, that we continue to add value to Malaysian client and also others customer globally. So that's my answer, Chai Izzat. Beside that, Chai Izzat, I would like to share the answer on the first question that you referred to Dato' Rafiq. Yes, if you're talking about last 15 years back, people perceive that Islamic banking is very expensive because that time we only have Syariah contract, Murabaha or BBA, of which we had the ceiling rate very high. And that perception maybe changed now because we can see a lot of straightforward, simplified community murabaha structure and also other products innovation. So I agreed with the Dato' Rafiq and Dato' Dobaka, one of the extra job that need to be done by financial institution is to do a lot of financial literacy, reach them, share the awareness of Islamic banking product, not only for the fair and transparency, but then even the commercial term almost similar to conventional, except they structured under Syariah form. That's my answer. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Dr. Dot, do you want to comment on that? Whether you know there are still perceptions that Islamic financing is still still expensive, especially among the small and medium enterprises who are not exposed to Islamic financing or who have only heard about Islamic financing only recently. Yeah. Or is that perception wrong? Or is that perception right?
I think perception is still perception. I don't think we can support their perception, but we need to do a bit more to remove their perception by engaging with them, by creating illustrative, you know, presentation to them, and perhaps by talking to their consultant and broker, perhaps, the one who created the problem, not the end customer, but also the intermediaries in between. So this is something I would like to add on. And before I, you know, leave this issue, I would like to comment as well that perhaps the time has come for Islamic banks and Islamic capital market to look into halal industry as one new portfolio, as if we're talking about SDG, about this, that, or this. Or perhaps, of course, we are financing Syariah compliant products, but they are not necessarily in halal industry. They are just normal. Buying a house is halal, but not halal industry. You know, financing a car financing is halal, is compliant, but they are not halal industry. So perhaps if I can propose to all the colleagues, excellent and amazing colleagues, that let's say in the West, they have the community desk, they have the bank focusing on community, on the value chain or plantation from the very beginning, or the silo management and whatnot. So perhaps if I can put on record, Chair Izzat, is to create a halal desk or halal portfolio within Islamic banks to really focus and understand the behavior of creating the halal industry from SME all the way to big MNC and whatnot. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Daud. Thank you for the suggestion to have that halal desk created at an Islamic financial institution or any other financial institution. We only have about 2 minutes left. I have one last question from the audience. This is perhaps more appropriate for Muhammad Izzat. Digitalization is trending now, and with fintech and blockchain, what is the acceptance by local company taking the facilities? Or may I open to any of the panel member to actually respond to this?
I can take the question first. So I think for Malaysia especially, we have a regulator SC that is quite forward thinking. For example, the digital investment management license is the first of such in the world that basically license a company to undertake a robo advisory activities. So if this kind of environment is disencouraging, encouraging environment is continuous going forward, then the digitalization of many companies across many industries are just a matter of time, and it was accelerated from the pandemic. From 2 years ago, we've seen a lot of physical companies shutting and moving their stores online, and those are just from the retail perspective. But going forward, I foresee a lot more industries digitalizing their offerings, and of course, the trends that we're seeing now, working from home, I think it's just going to be a new normal from now on. That's my take on it.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Sadly, we have come to the end of our panel discussion. I must say that it was very insightful and interesting discussion with the esteemed panelists. I wish more time could be given for us to deliberate even further on the topic, inshallah. If God permit, we shall meet again in the future. I would like to take this opportunity again to thank you, our esteemed panelists, Yang Berbahagia Datuk Dr. Daud Bakar, Yang Berbahagia Datuk Muhammad Rafiq, Encik Muhammad Suhaimi, and Encik Muhammad Izzat. With that, ladies and gentlemen, thank you and stay safe, everybody.
Come on.